Adam here, the Australian Aquarist. We're heading on down to the mangrove to collect some mud, believe it or not. Collect some mud and some sand, which will ideally contain some worms and crustaceans and microorganisms. We're going to go up to Sandy Beach, to the rock pool area, and we're going to collect some sediments from below and beneath. Oh, this is a terrible thing. That's why you shouldn't do two things at once, guys. You're driving and talking at the same time. It's not good. Sorry, mate. We're going to go up to the tidal pools at Sandy Beach and turn over a few rocks and collect some of the sediments and sands and microorganisms that are beneath those rocks. We're going to bring those materials back along with some live rock, and we're going to mix it all up with some very fine crushed shell grit that I've got at home and make up a nice, probably 4, 5, 6 inch deep substrate for my sand sifting goby aquarium. Sand sifting gobies, as you may be aware, are a group of different genuses of goby that rely on sifting through the substrate and the sediment to extract little tiny organisms and worms and crustaceans from that sand. They're often put into reef aquariums with the thought process of keeping the sand bed clean, but the trouble with it is they usually run out of things to eat. The sand bed's not sufficiently large enough or mature enough, doesn't have enough microorganisms in it, and they usually starve.
Right, actually, here we are on one of my local creeks. This is Boambi Reserve or Boambi Creek. I'm coming down to some of the mangrove areas just out here. We can see, well, you might not be able to see, but on the water there, it's very low tide. We've got the seagrass, which is all laying flat. Unfortunately, a lot of the mangrove trees here got hit by a very bad hailstorm, and it knocked out quite a lot of these trees that were quite exposed out in the center of the creek. But there's still plenty of healthy trees around. And this sediment, this mud that we've got right below our feet, is what we're going to be collecting. All the worms and crustaceans, and we might even go and get some from the edge of the seagrass bed just over there as well.
So from the mangroves, we're going up to the surf beach and Sandy Beach. That's my favourite collecting spot with the rocky platform and the tide pools. Shout out to Keith Berkelhammer from Rapping with Reef Bum podcast. Keep me a bit of company on the way up. Listen to his podcast, quite enjoyable. So let's get ready to go and collect some critters beneath some rocks and try and get some more biodiversity for our goby tank.
That island out there is Split Solitary Island, and South Solitary Island out there with the lighthouse on it. And this is the home of Aquaria solitariensis, and that's witches where we're going.
It's a really, really, really low tide. I think it's about a 0.0 low tide here this afternoon. The swell's actually really rough. I've got George, my faithful companion here, and I have got some sediments already, but I also discovered another fantastic source of copepods, and that is this stuff. This is actually the tube worm casings that at high tide, when the water comes in, all the tube worms come out. But all this this structure, which is made up basically of mucus and sand to form these tunnels, is full of worms, but also full of copepods and other microcrustaceans, which I'm going to take home a whole bunch of this as well, and pile up in the actual tank, and try and introduce a lot of crustaceans and copepods that way, and try and seed a lot of the life into my sand substrate utilizing those tube worm housings. So I'll do that, but also while I'm here, let's go through some of these rock pools and try and find some corals, because I know there are a few around, and we'll start just over here near George. So you can see he's a really nice bright orange, a little bit of green on him. See, he's barely covered by water in this rock pool. Dehydrated suspicial area from the low tide, surrounded by some valonia, and over here we've got some halimeda algae. There's a rock, giant rock, covered in palaethoa. Actually, if you look across that side there,
You'll also see a hole just there. Those rocks are also covered in palaeozoas. This is the big chunky bright green palaeozoa that has got that. I think it's the second most deadly toxin in the world. There you go. So you can see it's that nice big bright green one. Now I think I spotted just on the low side here. There we go. It's a turbinaria. It's actually facing the western side of this rock. So it's turbinaria micentaurina. He's literally in less than 30 centimeters of water. So waratah anemones are the big bright red, actually not that big, they're probably about 5 centimeters across, but they're bright red anemones that occur at this intertidal area. And when the tide goes out, they close up and form these burgundy blobs on the rocks. And then when the tide actually comes back in, their bright red tentacles come out. You can actually see them all the way along this rock crevice here, in the shade there. All on there, more waratah anemones near George's big foot.
Aussie aquarists, if you've got some hard fish to feed, some finicky eaters, check out frenzyfishfeeds.com.au. They're our Australian supplier of fish feeds. They've got their new website up and running. You can check out their new packaging and some of their ingredients. But if you're in a hurry, go straight to the product section and you'll find they've got a good listing there of their products available. But check out their live foods. Their live foods, they've got a whole variety, including grindle worms, banana worms, vinegar eels, and micro worms. And in that live food section, you can choose both a small starter kit or a large starter culture. Select the size that you're chasing, stick it in your cart. Now, what's really important as Aussie Aquarist is don't forget to put in the discount code Aussie Aquarist in capitals at checkout, and you'll get your 10% off your order. Let's get behind a good Australian company.
We do get these big turbo snails. There they are there. So in the hobby, turbo snails is one that's popular for grazing algae. I don't find them to be all that fantastic. In fact, they tend to knock over a lot of your corals and things because they're sheer size, and I have found that this species of turbo snail is actually a lot more adapted to cooler water conditions than our tropical marine tanks. So I'll pop him back. While I'm here, look what we've got here. We've got some mangrove proper gills starting to grow. So the mangrove, this is actually from the white or the grey mangrove, which is Avicennia maritima. Maritima, and they form these fruits that are proper gills that are these flattened dish shapes, and you can just see the little roots starting to come out. They've actually floated up here, probably the closest actual estuary to here. Where's Georgie? There he is. The closest estuary to here would be up at, geez, way out past Wagulga. Way up the coast. These guys won't have much luck growing here. There's not enough depth to the substrate. There's no mangroves in this area, so they'll eventually get washed out or perish or get eaten by herbivorous fishes or who knows what. Let's keep looking. This is the algae, which looks a bit like Ketomorpha. There's another mangrove there growing. Look at him. Stuck up on the rock there. So it's some nice roots on him. This is the algae I've used in my my tank alongside of the old wives. It's doing quite nicely. Actually haven't seen any shallow before up out of the water. Bright orange. They're almost like some sort of tube worm as well.
Righto guys, sorry, the GoPro ran out of battery power when I was out there at Sandy Beach. And I continue to get some sands, one lot from underneath those rocks. So I've got the gravelly sands from the rock pools, so I got some mangrove mud, and I also went to the aquarium store and I picked up some about 7 kilos of Great Barrier Reef live rock. So we're back home, let's get unpacked.
Oh, there isn't much privacy these days, is there? Oh well, since you're here, let me read you a bit of an excerpt from one of my favourite books. This one here, Marine Fishes by Scott W. Michael. Oh, there is his name down there, Scott W. Michael. This is actually quite a well-worn red book, but there's a great section here on my fish of interest at the moment, the signal goby, crab-eyed goby, or twinspot goby, all different names. So I'll read to you a bit. Scott gives this goby an aquarium suitability index of only 2 out of 5, saying that, unfortunately, it is difficult to keep and most individuals slowly starve to death. To succeed, use live sand as a substrate, attach a richly populated refugium, and feed the fish frequently. So that's exactly what I intend to do, and you can see I've already started with the substrate and the refugium in the form of that coral rubble and the tube worm housings. I've got one more book, stay there. Well, maybe I shouldn't be saying stay there, I might need some privacy after all. But anyway, this one here, another great book, A Guide to the Sea Fishes of Australia. It's a book that's designed for divers and for fishermen, but I find it to be a really good reference book. And again, in this section here with the gobies, here we've got the signal goby or the crab-eyed goby, and I'll read to you. Protected inner reefs on fine, often silty sand and rubble along the reefs, making a burrow under partly buried large solid objects. So silty sand, well, we've got mangrove mud and sediments from the creek, tick. Rubble, coral rock, tube worm housings, tick. And large, partly buried solid objects, and we've certainly got that. So, trying my hardest to get this tank set up to everything that my research has provided me with. And you can even see in the pictures to these actual gobies how dark and silty the actual sediment is, which is in complete contrast to the sparkling white sands that we want in our coral reef tank. And that's why I think I'm on the right pathway to success with this fish. But on that matter, I am a strong believer that every fish at some stage was impossible to keep, including the good old neon tetra. Impossible to keep until someone figures out how to do it. And that's exactly what I'm trying to do. Now, just a little privacy, thanks.
Plan now is to get a bit of a bulk container and to start mixing these ingredients up. I think I might actually wash the shell grit first. Sometimes it comes out with a lot of fines and a lot of that sort of dusty, cloudy kind of stuff. So I'll get a bucket and I'll start washing the shell grit. Righto, so I don't think this is going to be pretty. I really have no real structured plan other than to start mixing and see what happens. Sunk down in the bottom of the bucket. And that's why I'm out in the shed.
I've certainly got that nice smell of mangroves in my nose, put it that way. But I need a lot more than this, a lot more. So I've got to get busy.
Oh, what have I got, about 10 centimetres or so, or maybe 4 or 5 inches. And what I'm doing now is I'm going to go out and unpack the live rock I got from the local pet store, and we'll see what that's like. And I'm going to use that partially buried towards the back of the tank to add some structure for the gobies to burrow beneath, and also some structure for the microorganisms to hide within, but also to help build up the back layer and act like a sediment trap as such. Because I ideally want to have the tank where the substrate's higher at the back than the front. I'm going to have a dryer pump at the top there, sending water across the top, down the front of the glass, and back across the sand surface towards the back. Because I feel like over time, the activities of the gobies sifting through the sand would cause the sand to fall towards the front and the whole lot to flatten out. So I want that kind of flow to try and maintain the depth of the back. And I'm thinking that maybe if I've got some of that rock, it might help to actually act like a sediment trap and keep it there as well. I guess before we go too far, I should explain a little bit about the filtration for this tank. I built this tank out of 10 mil glass. And brand new glass for the sides and the rear walls, and recycled glass for the base. You can see here I've basically made an all-in-one tank. I've used some smoked glass as a false rear wall. This is 6mm glass, whereas this glass here is 10mm glass. And you can see I've actually cut a little bit of a rebate here as an overflow. So the water will overflow into this first chamber here, and then it'll go under that baffle through potentially some, in this case, I'm going to probably put some filter wool in there or some foam, overflow through a chamber here where I'll probably just put some activated carbon and come under here into this larger area here, which will just house the heater and the return pump. That's the idea, fingers crossed. So let's go unpack the live rock. So you can see it's quite branchy. Obviously old dead corals, some little corals. Get the focus on it. Some little corals growing just inside there. But you can see how nice and open this is, so it's gonna act like a good sediment trap and harbor plenty of microorganisms. I don't want this, there's a nice coral piece there. I don't want this to be a reef. This is meant to be a sandy, silty slope. So the rock is not going to feature. It's there as a structural support for the substrate. Come out here at night time, which of course is the best time to check out what kind of critters are lurking inside your aquarium with the aid of a head torch. You can see here that I've actually piled up the tube worm casings into the aquarium. I won't leave this many tube worm housings in the aquarium when it's time to introduce the fish, because it's well and truly congested. But I'm just trying to kickstart the actual seeding of the tank with all the different types of micro-crustaceans. You can see the little feathery tuft sticking out of the tube worm casings. That's the actual worm itself. There's stacks of crabs which are living their life amongst the housings, and they will also provide plenty of offspring and eggs to provide food sources for the gobies. There's plenty of sponges and a worm just up on there. And I've actually got there's a coconut shell I put in there. You can see the little white dots scurrying around the back glass. They're copepods. And I've actually introduced a couple of sea grape leaves into the aquarium, a bit like the old botanical method of aquarium in freshwater aquascaping or freshwater keeping. And what I've found is that if you look really closely onto the surface of the leaf, there we go, you can see those little tiny little white dots scurrying around. That's exactly what I'm looking for. That's the little copepods that are starting to breed. I'm not quite sure why they're so attracted to the leaf, but they certainly are, so I'm not going to take it out. I'll leave it in for quite a while and see if we can get some good populations developing. I am every now and then throwing in a food source. Oh, wow, look at that. Look at that. That's exactly what we're looking for. This is the great thing about coming out at night time with a head torch. So much stuff to actually see. So there's the food source that I throw in every now and then, which is a pellet. That's a 9mm pellet, thanks to Frenzy Fish Feeds. And look at those copepods that are just swarming down there. So these are the food sources that the sand sifting gobies rely upon. And that they sift from the actual sand itself. And during the first weeks or months of introducing a sand sifting goby into a reef aquarium, there are copepods and amphipods living in that sand, but it isn't long before the food sources become eaten and the gobies eventually starve. That's because we're trying to keep our reef aquariums pristine and spotless. But that's not in the best interests of the actual goby itself. You might be able to actually see the progression of the actual substrate there. You can see that there are certain layers there, which is inevitable. It's very hard to get a good homogeneous mix. But as time goes by, the worms and the microorganisms will burrow through those layers and actually start to mix it for me. You can see these areas of sort of green just down there, and that's an algae which is growing on this front surface because it's got more light out here. And those gas pockets, contrary to popular belief, are not nitrogen. They're actually oxygen produced by the algae. Let's see if I can come around the side here and start to see the worms growing their tunnels, and just the sheer depth of the substrate that I've got in this tank. So that's a good 8 to 9 inches or 20 to 23 centimeters deep, plus the rubble, the organic matter in the form of leaves and the roots from the mangroves. So this tank is well on the way to being seasoned for the introduction of the gobies.
So those of you who are hoping to see me introduce some sand sifting gobies into this aquarium in this video, I'm afraid I'm gonna have to disappoint you. I'm taking this process very seriously, and I am very prepared to let this tank season and mature to ensure that the populations of those worms and those copepods and crustaceans do build up to supply a significant proportion of the gobies' food. And that just does take time. So I am well aware that this goby is, as far as the hobby goes, considered to be impossible to keep. People are starting to make some headways with some sand sifting gobies and presenting foods into the sand itself for the goby to sift through, and I certainly will be trying that. I do, however, think that it's very important to respect the animal, respect the process, to research as much as you can, but certainly also to extend ourselves and actually to try these kind of ventures. But I am prepared to wait. And so you guys are going to have to wait as well. Stay tuned for the next video. We'll set up the refugium component of the all-in-one filter. So a lot of the leaves and the rubble and the tube worm casings I'll install into the back of the tank. I'll install some black background. That'll allow a much more open expanse of sand in the front for the goby to sift through. And we'll look at getting some lighting on the tank as well. If you're interested in trying to challenge yourself and want to come along for the ride, stay tuned for the next installment in Project Impossible. Thanks, guys. I'll see you later.